Welcome to another one of our series, and this one's on angels, fairies, and the unseen forces. How many of us here today have seen an angel or had an experience with an angel? All right. How many with a fairy? Any with a leprechaun? Or an elf? An elf. Okay, good. Well, we're going to explore these, and we're going to explore why some of us see them and some don't. Do you realize that all of us here have the same rods and cones in our eyeballs? Same. Yet some of us saw a spirit, an angel, a fairy, or something of the light realm, maybe momentarily or maybe frequently. So it's not the eyeballs. You understand? It's not the physical body. It has something to do with your state of consciousness. For example, a great story we have here is there used to be a camellia bush out behind the old building. And that was the only building we had for a long time. And then we had the second building. And one day, little Ruth Lenore, who I worked with, she was the leader of the prayer group, the Glad Helpers prayer group. She was coming down the stairs by the camellia bush, and all the little brownies were on the leaves in their green and red outfits with the curly shoes, and they had the little vest and the curly hat, and they said, if you go get your camera, we'll let you take a picture of us. Of course, Ruthie turns around and runs in to get it. Well, Hugh Lynn's office, Edgar's firstborn son, sees the brownies in the bush because his office is right next to the bush. He comes out. Here comes Ruthie. They're both looking at the bush. Well, Joan Grasser, a colleague I worked with for years, and David Abrig, at the time he was the official photographer for A.R.E. Here's Ruthie taking pictures of the brownies in the bush, and David can't see them. Neither can David's camera when he looks through. So he's very frustrated, and Joni can't see them. She turns to Hugh Lynn and says, Hugh Lynn, why can you two see them and we can't? And he said, because it's more a state of consciousness than it is a certain type of eyeball. Do you understand? Your physical body is not limiting you from doing this. Now, in some cases, not seeing them is what your soul wants to happen for a few years or many years or this whole lifetime, because your soul wants total focus on the opportunity in the external world. You understand? Because you know how we get. If we get into something airy-fairy, we run off with it, you know, and we don't get anything done. And I lived through the 60s in which many of us were airy-fairy. And we didn't do anything. And then we got to be 30 years old and had to go get a career. You know, if we were going to get married and have babies, somebody had to put the roof and the food. And the next thing you know, we became very physical, very real. And by the time we were 40, some of us were executives, making money, in debt. So you see, there's this movement back and forth. And Edgar Cayce's readings say, this incarnation, your soul was intentional and purposeful in coming here to learn some lessons, be a gift to others who are going to struggle through this life, and to grow our intuitive, soulful senses over our physical senses. And so you see, what we're going to talk about today is, Edgar said, psychic ability is nothing more than the natural senses of your soul. You're in your body, so you have the five senses of your body. If you get in touch with your soul self and you allow it more presence, now you start to develop a sixth sense. We all talk about the sixth sense, don't we? We know it's there. Well, that, Edgar says, is because you opened up a little more and you let the subconscious self, the deeper self, through the veil. And so it's more present. And intuition, the sixth sense, comes. But there are more. And eventually you can have clairaudience, clairvoyance, and they come. But you have to stay focused on your soul's purpose for this incarnation, because if you don't achieve that, no matter how great your psychic senses are, you miss the opportunity. And Edgar said, when you pass over, when you die, your body dies and your personality is absorbed back into your soul. He says, it looks at this life like you would a picnic basket. And he says, sometimes you lift the cloth over the, and there's not much in there. And the soul's very disappointed. And sometimes it's brimming over with nourishment and soul food, and your soul is thrilled, and it was a great incarnation, and you did your best. In some cases, he said, you don't have to come back for a long time, or you can come back quickly. In the Buddha teachings, if you do achieve a certain level of enlightenment, you are free of the wheel of birth, life, death, rebirth, the constant reincarnation of the karmic wheel. However, there's also the teaching of the Bodhisattva, which means you have overcome the wheel, but you love us and we're still idiots and you're coming back to help us. Do you see? So some of you might be here simply because you care about others, and it's a tough life, but you put up with it anyway to help us, and that's a bodhisattva energy. So there's a lot of dynamics going on with unseen forces that we need to be aware of, and Edgar Cayce's wonderful readings help us to look into these other dimensions. Another thing I want to start with is an understanding of the light and dark forces. And I write about this a lot. There definitely is evil, but in the highest archetype of this teaching that goes back 5,000 BC, the highest archetype, dark is not evil. Dark is unseen, hidden. That's what that word means. We do have evil. I'm with you all the way on that. But I want you to know in the classic teaching, dark is hidden, not evil. This is the yin and the yang, the unseen and the seen, the hidden and the obvious. Now, if Carl Jung was doing this, the depth psychologist, some of you know Carl Jung a little bit, this would be the anima and the animus. If you look objectively at our physical bodies, which weren't created until Genesis chapter 2, verse about 18 or 20. We were androgynous prior to that period. You realize male and female were not separated until the second chapter of Genesis, but we were created in the first chapter. You got that? That's something we lost touch with. We need to be aware of that. Well, Jung comes out today in the last century and says to us, hey, John, you're a male. If you want to get in touch with your whole self, you got to get in touch with your... Oh, man, it's been hell. And where is my feminine, my yin? Within me. He says to women, if you want to get in touch with your whole self, you got to get in touch with your masculine, and it's within you. And we've been doing this now for almost 100 years, of this, we think it's nothing more than a social movement or a psychological movement, but actually it goes back to chapter 2 of Genesis, in which the two parts were separated. And I'm only projecting one part. The soul actually has both. So the hidden in me is the anima. And Jung would say to us, if in a dream I had a dynamic, frightening, or powerful female, that was my soul talking to me, the other part of my soul. You see, it's within me. If you, a woman, if you have a powerful, terrifying, or spectacular male in your dream, it is often your hidden part, because that's within your subconscious on the other side of the veil. and I'll prove to you that you are so comfortable with your whole self, you don't even realize it when you're in it, because it is you. All of us at one time or another have been waking in the morning and something's going on in our minds, a dream, a nightmare, an impression of some kind going on in our minds. And we're searching that and thinking, wow, this is interesting. This is really interesting. And then we realize our bladder's full. So we say, well, I'll just run to the bathroom, empty the bladder, come back and work on this dream, right? You go to the bathroom, empty the bladder, you come back. What? It's gone. How is that possible? It was profound. It had my attention. And now I can't even pick it up. You just experienced the two parts of yourself and the veil between them. When you engaged your somatic nervous system to move the body, you came through the veil into the part of you that's in charge of the bladder. But it didn't dream the dream. This is so subtle, you don't notice you're coming through it, but it's so opaque, you can't see back through it. But if you reclined on the bed for a little while and didn't have to rush off to work, you would slip back into it, right? And there would be a part of it. And then the psychologists say the associative process would get the dream back because it was linked together. So you are familiar. When you were sleeping and that dream was going on, you were comfortable. That was you. You knew it was you. So you see, you're closer to it than you think. If you haven't seen an angel or a fairy yet, don't worry. You are very close. It's just a matter of a shift in consciousness. Here's the classic Shiva and Shakti, which symbolize the classic yin and yang, the inner and the outer. I'm trying not to make it sex or gender, though it has that element. You see, if you look at a woman's body objectively, just everything about her is within her. If you look at a male body objectively, it projects, it has erection, it is out here, it has upper body muscle power. It's a projected outer. That's the yang, yin and yang, you see? She conceives within her. She's with the cycle of the moon every 28 days. She gestates new life within her. You don't see it, but it's there. You do see the effects. When it's delivered, she can bring food for it right from within her own body. You see, within, yin, yang. And of course, Carl Jung does animus, anima. And so if you're aware of this and you want a bigger consciousness, a more expanded consciousness, you do have to get in touch with your deeper self. And it's usually a complement to your outer self. And you are familiar with it. You've been in it every night almost. It depends. If you ate a pizza at midnight, you never made it. But if you didn't, you've been in it every night. Okay, we're going to start with the wonderful legends and lore of fairies, elves, gnomes, and leprechauns. And I had my first real, well, actually, my first one was my brother. My youngest brother had an experience with a leprechaun that I'll share with you when we get to leprechauns. But my second experience was in the London Chalice Well Garden by the Tor. Some of you might know that area. Well, it's full of fairies. I mean, it is just a magical place. And that was the first time I saw them there, at least the first time my outer self was aware of seeing them. I might have seen them when I was a little boy and all, but my mother, who just passed on, 97 years old, she was a little Irish Catholic girl from an inner city, and she saw them all the time. And she would yell out things. My three brothers and I, this was before seat belts, we would be on the bench seat. And the front seat was a bench, and the three of us would be in the back seat like this, and she'd be yelling out to fairies and angels. <We'd> look, but she saved us many a time, I'm telling you. Okay, so we're going to get into this. They are delicate. They are light. They are not composed of flesh and bone. They aren't thick. They aren't heavy. their light. Edgar explained that they live in the fourth dimension just beyond ours, but they can manifest in the third. And so at the Trellis Well Garden, I was looking at a little waterfall, and it was sparkling water and all, but I started to see white light sparkles coming above the water, and then I sensed, eventually saw them as little fairies. So they can stay beyond your normal view, or they can manifest. But actually, I felt that day it was the reverse. They didn't move, I did. Do you see the difference? I was staring at them, at the water, then I saw the light, and then I was so desperate to see them because I was writing a book, and I thought, you can't write a book on this unless you know them. So I was desperate to see. Suddenly I shifted somehow, and then I saw their bodies, their forms. Not like our bodies. Of course, they love certain environments. You're most likely to see them around nature and in a nature setting. At the intersection in a big city, you might catch one or two there to help you, but normally they wouldn't abide there. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is more their environment. Throughout history, the environment has always been nature associated. I put this up here because if you go further back in classics, fairies never had wings. That occurred during the Elizabethan time. That's only a few hundred years, you know. Prior to that, all the legends, fairies don't use wings. They fly by magic. They don't fly, but see, we were going into the science age, so we had to have a reason they could fly. So we put dragonfly wings on their back. Or butterfly wing, you see what I'm saying? That was our creation. Legend, they never had it. They never had wings. But we love these drawings. These turn us on, man. That's a real fairy. This other gal's just a female, no wings. I can't be a fairy. The origin of fairies is very difficult to trace, but all the scholars that have tried to do it come up with the three fates. Now this goes way, way back. Three fates is known in all the mythologies of ancient lore, the three fates. And here they are in a painting that is very helpful to see them weaving in the fabric of time. And they influence you. Now you and I today would probably call them the ladies of karma. Do you see? That's your fate. Do you get the idea? You were born into a certain family of a certain socioeconomic structure in a certain country with a destiny of that country, of that family, of those parents. You're fated. Already your fate casts you into a certain situation. Now Edgar comes along and says, your soul knew that and your soul was involved in accepting that. I was about 19 when I read that, and I knew he was wrong, because there was no way I picked these parents. There was no way. I had nightmares about being born to my parents. And in those nightmares, I would be so terrified when I saw myself coming to them. And then suddenly someone would shake my arm and wake me and say, honey, you're just having a nightmare. It's okay. And I'd look up, and it was my mother. Who was the demon in the dream? And I would go, ah, no. She would go into my dad and say, I don't know about that child of yours. But later we grew to love one another. We played bridge together. We played golf together. We got to really heal the whole karmic crap that we had to deal with. Okay, here are the three fates. The spinner, the allotter, and the unturnable. Now, Edgar, when it came to the unturnable, said, you will meet what you have done, but you can meet it in grace or in full-out karma. That's your choice. Whoa. I immediately wrote that reading down, carried it in my pocket, because I wanted to meet every bit of my karma in grace. I read a reading where he told this one woman, your karma is to die in car accidents, vehicle accidents. Be careful who you get in the car with. Then he paused and he said, however, this doesn't have to become physical. If you in your heart and mind work with God on what you have done and your desire to be forgiven and your shift in your heart. Well, I love that. Okay, rather than have it real, let's have it. I'll work it out. But you have to invite God into you, and now you're stark naked before the all-knowing, and you say, yeah, I am a mess, but I want to work with you on this mess. So, origin of fairies is pretty much tracked back to the three fates. And the origin of their word, of their name, seems to be associated with that a great deal. Edgar Cayce, these are, when I say EC, that's the reading number. Time is as one time, space as one space, to the cosmic consciousness. So karma is with you, even though you're innocent as can be. You did not do anything bad, and yet your life's a mess. And you go, why me, Lord? Well, let me show you. Here's the timeline. So back here, let's see, you're looking at it this way. Back here, let's say your soul did something harmful to itself or others. And so as you go along the timeline, you're born here with a fresh new start. Jesus said, we clean your house and sweep it clean, and you return with seven devils and clutter it up again. Okay, so here we are up here. Now, if it looks innocent and you have no connection to this, unless you rise above the timeline like a bird above a river, and then you can see the source and the destiny. It's all there. One time, one space. So at a certain level of awareness, like if in a dream or a meditation you become expanded in consciousness, like the bird above the river, you will sense all that's a part of you and how it all needs to be resolved and fully realized. And the fates play a great role in that. There are two basic legends about fairies. Little fairies, and that's what Hugh Lynn and Ruthie saw, little tiny brownie fairies. Brownies are part of the fairy community in the camellia bush. But there are also full-grown female fairies, and the most famous is Morgan Le Fay. I'm sure you've heard Morgan Le Fay. If you've watched a movie, she's in it, especially anything to do with King Arthur. So this is something you must be aware of. When I was in the Chalice Well Garden, I saw only little fairies. I would have freaked out if I saw a full size. So I'm glad Morgan Le Fay wasn't hanging around that garden. Two other things you must be aware of. There are troop fairies who go in communities and solo fairies. One year, I had a solo fairy in my garden, in my backyard, and she was there, and then she didn't come back. I don't know, I planted the wrong thing, or it wasn't. So anyway, there are solo fairies, and there are troop fairies in the lore. There are tiny fairies, and there are full-size fairies. The fairies are closely associated with the elves because the legend is the elves make their shoes and fairies love to dance, so they go through shoes real fast. I think we should look at this like interpreting a dream. You see what I mean? They're understanding shoes, understanding, and they do so much that they wear their understanding out, and then they need some fresh understanding. You see where I'm going with this as a dream? But it is true, you will see elves associated with fairies. Now, this is one of the weirdest readings Edgar Cayce gave. It was for an oil man. Now, he had come from Texas up here, and he wanted to get a reading on how he could find oil, And Edgar tells him that the brownies have been trying to tell him where the oil is the whole time, but he doesn't listen. And this guy asked Edgar if he should go to London and talk to a scientist. And Edgar said, no, you should talk to the brownies. They know where the oil is. That sure shifts your mind, doesn't it? It shifted me. I was in my 30s when I read this reading, and I started to look more for intuitive guidance rather than external guidance from my brilliant uncle or my professor or some author of a book. I started to try to seek intuitive guidance, a sense of where the right direction was. And that really changed my life for the better. I hadn't written a book. I was late 30s before I wrote my first, and those efforts from about 30 to 38 brought the flow of ability to write a book, because the flow of creative awareness started to happen because I went within instead of always without. Elves are much more like us. Not physically speaking, in flesh and bone, but they have human weaknesses. Fairies don't. They're blithful spirits, happy. As you could tell, Ruthie was looking at happy little brownies with no issues at all. I don't know how they felt 10 years later when they chopped a camellia bush down. You know, paved over paradise in the song, you know. But they are, that's not the case for elves. Elves really struggle with our challenges of the human frailties, and they have those. Also, legend holds that elfin males are attracted to human females. But I think that was a Middle Ages thing to scare the women into submissive activity. Honestly, if you look through the historical lore, you see this crap going on. And you know it's that age where woman is starting to rise with the goddess energy and the men are going, oh no, oh my God. No, don't let that happen. And they create stories. And anyway, that's just my opinion. Now, Hollywood has done elves with pointed ears a lot, and that's okay. But again, in the Elizabethan time, in that era, they put them in with fairies, and that's a mistake. All those authors, if you read authors who are using Elizabethan history or lore, they will lump elves in with fairies. They are a distinct, different species, if I may use that word. They are distinct from that. And you should keep that in mind. I have not actually seen or experienced an elf or elves in any way, and I haven't met too many people, only one, that has had experience with them, so I can't give you too much. The one thing that is historical is they have incredible libidos, which means elves are very sexually oriented with each other. Fairies are not. They're dancing. They're having fun. Here's Hollywood. Oh, man. What we do with our legends. Okay, we come to leprechauns. Having an Irish Catholic mother, and I had my father's still alive. He's 90, gonna be 98. She had total belief in leprechauns. Now that affects you when you're a little child, okay? My littlest brother, Paul, back in those days, we had the draft into the military and Vietnam War was going on. So I went and I signed up for the Naval Air. My brother behind me, the second brother, he was 4F because he had acne on his back and they wouldn't let you go to Vietnam because it always got infected. So they gave, and he was much stronger and more powerful than me, became an FBI agent. And he was so furious that little old squirrely me listening to classical music got 1A and he got 4F. He was furious. He didn't talk to me for months over that issue. But my third brother, Paul, he was terrified. He was a light, happy-go-lucky guy. So he was then by the time Paul came up, it was the lottery. They drew numbers, and Paul's number was very low, so he knew he was going to Nam. And he was crying on my mother's living room floor, in the living room, on the carpet. He was crying when he heard something, and he looked up, and there was a leprechaun. Now, I think my mother had drawn that spirit. And he had his leather apron on like he had been making shoes and all. And he had his hands on his hips and he was rocking like this. And he says, "You ain't going anywhere." And Paul blinked, but the words were so profound. He knew it was true, even though his lottery number was ridiculously low. And he blinked and the guy was gone. The little leprechaun was gone. Now, I've asked Paul this story every 10 years, and he tells it exactly the same way, so I'm pretty sure he's telling me the truth. Then he took a deep breath, he sat up, and he knew the words that leprechaun spoke were absolutely true, and sure enough, the lottery came up to within 5 numbers of his, and we stopped it, and he didn't go. I think it would have helped him if he had gone into the military, because he's now 68 and still a little loosey-goosey, you know. Discipline would have helped him. But I actually think my mother had brought that influence, too. I want you to be aware of that. She was very much a mystical lady. One time, my father was a naval officer. We were stationed in Argentia, Newfoundland. And there was a huge snowstorm, ice on the road. Again, my brothers and I were like this on the bench seat. She was driving. And all the cars are sliding, and there's a cliff that goes down into Fjord down here. And we're all sliding and everything and crashing and thing. And she's trying to be very careful when suddenly we get tapped from behind and our car goes toward the cliff down into the fjord. And she yells out these sacred names of all the saints in heaven, God and all that. And the car turns around and goes up the hill this way. Then she yells, "Get out of the car and run up the hill. Get out of the car." And we get out of the car, we run up the hill, and here comes this truck. He hits our car, it goes right off the cliff into the fjord. And my brothers and I turn to each other and say, "We got to stay close to Mom. She's got good friends in high places." She was a character. Enchantress, especially with Morgan Le Fay, because you remember Morgan dupes King Arthur into giving her his seed so she can create his enemy, his counter, because she's mad at him for what he did to her, or what his father did to her mother. So the enchantress goes way back. This is a document from ancient Egypt of the enchantress Anhai. I'm trying to show you how old the idea of the feminine enchantress is. Again, I think that lore is because the feminine symbolizes the inner, the soul self in an archetypal view. Therefore, to the outer willful self who wants to do everything the way they want it done, seeks self and self-gratification, self-glorification, the inner self is a trickster, enchanter toward a higher view of life that's not so self-focused. Do you see what I'm saying? I think that lore has the feminine is always the enchantress. But you can, especially with Morgan Le Fay, the full-grown female fairies can be enchanting and create a hypnotic sort of feeling in others. But I also think in the Middle Ages, in the Elizabethan period, men used that as excuse. Remember the comedian who said, "The devil made me do it"? Well, in the Middle Ages, up into the, I guess we would call it the Enlightenment period, men were using excuse was, she made me do it. And remember how in religion they started to develop the idea that Eve tricked Adam into eating it. She didn't trick him. She said, boy, I ate this. This is pretty good. He said, okay, I'll take some too. But they spin it differently. I think that's where a lot of this comes from. And here she is. She's done in many different views. Morgan Le Fay, and literally Le Fay is French for fairy. And you have to understand that really the legend starts with her mother, Lady Igraine, Duchess of Cornwall. Again, I think we're muddling etheric truth with human imagination, okay? But anyway, it begins with Lady Igraine. She is technically the daughter of Lady Igraine. And Arthur's father actually kills Igraine's husband and takes her as his wife, but she's already a baby girl and she sees it and she's psychic. You know the story, I assume many of you do. And she perceives this, so she's going to get even with Uther is her is Arthur's father's name. She's going to get even with Uther by damaging Arthur. And so she transforms herself and slips into Arthur's bed one night and technically rapes him to get his seed to create Mordrin, who does kill Arthur eventually. But Arthur is taken up into heaven and Mordrin dies, and you know how the story goes on. But this is the complicated thing. Again, I think if you look at this as a dream, you're actually looking at the battle between the ego and the soul, the selfish ego and the higher purposed heart soul of yourself. It's all a battle within yourself. All of these are within yourself. And this battle goes on until you are grow weary of duplicity, deception, rationalizing why you can eat cake at midnight. You know, all these little things we do to rationalize, and then later we regret. In the Cayce readings, he said, the worst is regret. And I can testify to that. I look back over my life, and when I see those things, I wished I hadn't said that. I wished I hadn't done that. Now, I have been healed of that. In the last few years, I've been healed of that, and I'll share with you why. About 6 years ago, my longtime wife that I had my children with, and we had a good marriage, a typical marriage. I mean, it wasn't perfect, but it was good overall. She died of cancer. So I was, a couple of years later, I was in Australia leading a tour. And we had a wonderful long day on the outback. And I came back to the hotel exhausted, and I passed out on the bed in the hotel room. And I woke in a room she had designed. And there she was, looking fantastic. And she had made tea for us. And I was just so thrilled. It was just wonderful. And she said to me, you keep thinking about all the things you should have said, you wished you have said, you should have done, and you wished you have done. She said, I'm going to tell you right now, none of those carry over to where I am now. Only the good things we did and how we raised those children. So then she leans over like this and looks me straight in the eye. And believe me, when she does that, you pay attention. And says, do you think you can let go of that loop thinking that you're doing all the time of regret? Well, I was ready for that release. Yes, I can. She smiled, she stood up, and then she looked a little funny. I said, oh my God, I'm not supposed to be here. She said, no, not yet. Bye-bye. And I woke up on that hotel bed. Yeah, God. I wanted to get back so bad because the vibes there were so great. And here I am in this hotel bedroom. So, but that changed me. I stopped loop thinking. I moved on. I knew focus on the positive, subdue the negative, move on, keep going. Here are the various actresses who have tried to portray Morgan Le Fay in different ways, from a little crazy to actually evil, to just a beautiful woman, to a magician herself, equal to, what's this guy's name? Merlin, thank you so much. Equal to Merlin. And remember, these two in the movie convey a relationship of relatives in a way, because they are of the community that's not actually human, of the community of fairies and magicians and all. And he says to her, our time is coming to an end. We're going to go deeper into nothing but materialism, and humans are going to rule and forget about us. Magic will no longer be, because science will rule. And now suddenly we're having this swing back where scientists are of the new physics are becoming almost magicians and talking about time dimension and double reality and all of this parallel universes. And so in some ways we're coming back around now to where even the scientists are seeing an expanse of reality way beyond physicality. And so I think we're actually in a period of getting beyond this. Nature spirits are really, throughout our literature, Shakespeare used them often. You'll find them in classical literature a lot. Undines are the water spirits. Salamanders are the fire spirit. Now, my late wife's family were Scottish Douglases, and their symbol was the salamander, and they asked me to research it, so I did. Well, the salamander had two qualities, the physical salamander and then the fiery powerful. So fire was associated in ancient times with the salamander. Sylphs were the spirit of the air, sylphides, and they are in La Sylphide by Shakespeare and Midsummer Night's Dream. Paracelsus, I'm going to show you some of his stuff in just a minute. He wrote all about these. In fact, he is the only extant source for this information, and it only comes from the 1500s, unless you use Greek and Roman mythology. Then you can get a little more of this. Of course, the Native Americans totally lived integrated with nature spirits, and they built totems. They identified characteristics of their personality with certain animal energies, and you were supposed to become aware of the animal archetype that you were acting like, that your spirit was similar to, and that would help you. And this is not only in North America, but Central and South America all had this concept, and we've reignited it again by bringing up their stories lately. Gnomes are really tricksters, not our real friends. They love to bring us our karmic weakness and make us trip over it. Here's Edgar Cayce talking to a woman. Don't be afraid to acknowledge that you see fairies as you study, for you will nurture these experiences. Don't be afraid to say that you see the gnomes, which would hinder people at times. So even he acknowledges gnomes. So I think the tour company, the hotel company on TV, might have made a mistake, kind of like General Motors picking Saturn for their car. Saturn has a negative. Gnomes are not exactly going to get you the right hotel, because their goal is to help you grow. Don't want to grow right now. Just comfort. Okay, to another person he explained, before this incarnation, the entity was in Scotland. The entity began its activity as a prodigy, as one already versed in the associations with the unseen or elemental forces, the fairies and those of every form that do not give expression in the material, like we are, way, and are only seen by those who are attuned to the infinite. Now, it's not your eyeballs, it's your consciousness. Even he comes out and says that. And Hugh Lin, his son, told David that that's why he and his camera couldn't see them. He had a reality dimension that was so strongly structured, he couldn't pick up on a fourth dimensional reality because the three dimensional was the only reality. Whereas Ruthie was very much, she was meditating, you know, two or three times a day. She was a loving heart. She had dreams of angels and things. She was a spirit of great expansive awareness of the mystical. So she did see them. Fairies, pixies, sprites, brownies, nixies, gnomes, nature spirits, kobolds, duendes, goblins, wee folk, elves, fauns, trolls. I'm going to show you trolls in a minute. The fates, I showed you those, and so on. However, you must be careful not to link mermaids, mermen, centaurs, satyrs, sirens, harpies, and others of this kind. They are not part of that community we're talking about. According to Edgar Cayce, they are a result of the earth not having any humans, and then the spirits of us human beings wanting to come in, and there's no physical body, no human physical body yet. Edgar called it no perfect body. So we pushed our way into animals and looked in this dimension using their senses because we were powerful spirits, and so we could push ourselves into their nervous system. And the problem was when we withdrew with some of their characteristics. And so half horse, half man, half bird, half woman, half fish, half woman, mermaid, you know. That's what Edgar explains. I know it's bizarre, but it's in our mythology everywhere if you look in the mythology. But these are not part of the little people, the fairies, the sprites and all. These are definitely us making a mess of physicality. Then Edgar says, Genesis chapter 6, God regretted making them. It was a mess. So God's going to start over, cleanses everything, makes a more perfect body, or keeps the bodies that were human-esque, like Noah and his family and all. And the story is much bigger than just the Noah's. Anyway, and we go on now totally giving seed to itself. The law of nature was everything gives seed to itself. So a fruit tree births a fruit tree, a cat births a cat, and humans birth humans, no more mixing of them. Now in Hinduism, transmutation or transmigration was still a concept, but Edgar says it was true in the beginning, but it stopped, and now everything is structured more tightly, and that happened in chapter 6 of Genesis, just so you're aware. Okay, here's my favorite slide. These are trolls. This is Mother Troll, and this is the little fairy they found. And Mother Troll says, look at them, Troll Mother says. Look at my sons. You won't find more beautiful trolls on this side of the moon. She wants her to marry one of her troll. I just love the picture, so I put it up there. You know, Harry Potter captured the generation, or maybe two below me, the one below me or two below me, because they read these. Now, these are kids don't read. They use cell phone. They were reading these books this thick, every one of them, and loving it. And this is part of that lore. And I think it's because somewhere inside them, they knew magic was there. They knew there were many qualities of beings and spirits and all. And they loved those stories. Okay, now we're going to jump to the elementals. Now, Edgar explains elementals are not quite people or beings. They are the fundamental elements of building life. And they are water, earth, fire, and air. Those are the four basic elementals. Now, in human lore, there is found a legend of a fifth element. In human lore, the fifth element is ether. It happened mostly, it got real intense when medical science in the past, 500 years, discovered the ability to make you so unconscious they could cut you open, fix you, and sew you up using ether. But ether was very uncontrollable, and so they had to progress. So when I was writing about this, I interviewed an anesthesiologist. And do you know what these top pros who make millions of dollars told me? They have no idea how it works. That's what they told me. They just know the right mixture for the right body weight type. They don't know how it is that they can put you unconscious so they can cut your body open, work on you, sew it back up, and wake you up, and you're okay. They don't know how it works. But they have fine-tuned ether. They're not using ether. Don't say John said they're using ether. But what happened was humans said, there is an element somewhere that will enchant a human into an altered state that is beyond physical life. And so they have now the five elements. Scientists come along and they say, no, the fifth element is plasma, electrified particles. I'll show you that in a minute. And this helps a lot. Okay, here's Paracelsus. In 1566, he shows the connection of the four elements, and like I already went through with you, the gnome is earth, undine is water, and sylph is wind, salamander is fire. Now there, Edgar associates them with the four lower chakras in your body. This is really interesting. When he starts to give this association, it's because he sees oneness. And the oneness means everything you see that is separate has a unity to it in a certain manner. And the unity of the four lower chakras with the elementals is your lower earthy self. And then you move into this will chakra that he says is like the ether or the plasma of higher vibration. Here are three Cayce readings on the concept of elementals. Those things that deal more with the elementals or with the constituents of things rather than people will bring the greater mental and physical development for the entity. Apparently, Mr. 621 had been in past lives studying, applying, and working in a field to where today he would be more dynamic as a physical scientist or probably a physicist, physics, you know, because modern physics has really taken us to more mystical levels. These then again may be part of the entity's experience if there will be made the closer walk with the creative forces. Edgar uses this term a lot, and this will really help you see and commune with the subtle beings, the unseen world, because dark forces, destructive forces, negative forces will inhibit you and will actually attract negative energy. But creative forces are the life-giving, uplifting forces, and they will attract all the life forces. Therefore, you will be able to start to see the unseen elements of life, activities of the mental, the material, the spiritual. For first in spirit, then in mind the builder, may there come, even as then in her past life, the healing forces for the entity through the application of that which is the healing power in mechanical means, in the spirit, in the chemical, and in the elementals or the vapors that become a part of every experience before it becomes manifested form. Are you seeing what he's giving her? Don't focus so much on the outer body and physical form. It's composed of these other elements. You see where he's taking us here? For first the seed, then the awakening. Now that's the magic. There are seeds. Some will awake and grow. Some will not. So there is an element, he says, that's not physical, that is the spirit, the awakening. And then the movement, the progress, and then the activity. Then doth the blade appear, the leaf, the blade appear. Then doth the stalk and the ear shoot forth. So with man in his seeking. Take hold upon those things that are not elementals, but the elements of the influences that impel individuals. Remember now, this takes us to the Native Americans saying, what energy is dynamic in your personality? There are animals and qualities in the earth reflecting that energy. What impels different individuals? My three brothers and I are all different. We have this different motivative spirit in us, and that makes us different. And trying to discover yours is very important. And this is the deeper self of the entity, the deeper self of the entity, the impelling force in the lives of individuals, of groups, of states, of nations, of a whole earth. So you can look around the planet and see nation motivations that are different than ours and perspectives on life. You can look at the state of Mississippi from California. That's pretty easy. Do you see what Edgar's saying? You catch the spirit, the motivation force, and different groups. Like when I'm over at CBN and the 700 Club, the fundamentalist Christian group over there, I am very different than I am here. I have to be. They have a different motivation. Do you know when I'm over there, I know don't use the word meditation because that means you're a new ager. Oh, the devil himself has got you. But if I say silent prayer, they love it. What's the difference here? I love silent prayer. Oh, I do too. Silent prayer. And I go, man, if I had said meditation, this woman would have decked me right there. But I said silent prayer. Okay, here's the diagram. Edgar's reading here, and he's giving you, and you can see, I am in a solid body, but if you've ever meditated, you can get into a level of vibration, and I'm from the 60s easily, so I know vibrations, I can feel more fluid, and if somebody coughs or slams the door or something, it's like they threw a rock into my pond, and I get all whacked out, but if I stay in the meditation, I will settle the pond again, so I'm very fluid, like liquid. If I keep getting excited and higher and inspired, I start to become like vapor, and my vibrations of my solid particles are speeding up. Do you see what I mean? The electrons are jumping out of their field, and I'm getting more excited, and I feel like vapor, cloud-like. And remember, the angel said, you will see Jesus return as you saw him go, as by clouds. Hint, hint, higher vibes. To us 60s people, that's higher vibes. Do you see? Then all the scientists are telling us is that vapor, when it becomes charged particles, it's plasma, and now it's alive with power. I think that's the spirit meets your effort, and suddenly you are getting the life force charge that you're looking for, and you really come alive, and you become more youthful, more vital. Your body is better, your mind is better. Changed in its vibrations to produce the element or the force, as is termed in man's terminology as dimensions that give it, whether may be solid, liquid, gas is vapor, gas, or what its form or dimension. If you think of these things when you try to meditate or when you're, like back in the 60s, we used to say to each other, oh man, she's got good vibrations. Do you know what that meant? You could feel her vaporous dynamic. You could feel. And then we'd also say, oh man, watch out for her. She got bad vibes. Do you remember that? We even wrote songs about vibes. All right, this is one of my favorite slides. Edgar Cayce says, spirit is the natural, normal condition of an entity. I'm standing up here in this overweight lump of flesh, blood, and bone, and he's telling me it's not my natural condition. My natural condition is spirit. That's really tricky to awaken to. But here, if you look back, you'll actually see the Egyptians are drawing my body and telling me I have a bird-like quality of my soul that is lighter and able to lift out of the body. And they'll draw us like light beings and angelic essences. Then we get all these daggone books. Do you know, in 1920s, Edgar Cayce said in the late 60s, early 70s, you will have a new view of death. What happened in the early 70s? These doctors became so sophisticated you could die on them and they could bring you back to life. That's fantastic. Emergency room or operating room, you die and immediately they go with chemicals. Everyone in this room knows what I mean when I yell out the word clear. I'm about to use electricity, aren't I? Yeah. All these, the trouble was in the recovery room. The doctor would go in and say, man, we had a close one on you. You died in there. Yeah, I was amazed, the patient would say. I was standing over in the corner, and when you jumped up on my chest like that, I was shocked. The doctor would go, wait a minute, you were dead. I thought it was strange too, but I was right there, and I watched what the nurse did and what you, and they wrote all these books, beginning with Raymond Moody. He really started it, and I used to travel and lecture with him. He's aged a lot now. But even modern books are coming out with Eben Alexander and some lady, I don't know who that is. But basically the concept is we had your big lump of flesh dead on the table. And you were still somewhere in that room because they perceived what went on. And then the stories get bigger. They tell you what happens. Most all of them saw the panorama of their whole life before them, and they were viewing it and reflecting on it. Most all of them say there was a barrier or some sort of thing, and they knew if they went through it or beyond it, they were not coming back on the operating room table. They would truly die. But they didn't. Sometimes the reason they went back was their own worry for someone they loved and knew they needed their help. So they went back into the body. Some, a light being, told them it's not your time and they felt themselves being forced back. Fortunately, I had one of these experiences so I can share real life. I was in a double room in the hospital. Oh, it was a minor injury to I caught my hand in a printing press. When I was in my 20s, I was a printer, running big printing presses, Heidelberg, huge suckers. And I caught my fingers and they broke and were torn up. And this one knuckle was damaged. So the doctor said, oh, I can fix that knuckle. And I said, okay. So I went in. So I'm in a double room with a roommate in the hospital ready for my operation. Somehow, someone wrote his weight on my thing. And it was like 360 or something like that. And when she hit me with the initial anesthesia, I went straight back on the bed. I know this because my roommate told me later what happened. That's the only way I know what happened. He said, it looked like she had killed you. You went pale white, dropped onto the bed dead. She pounded the button and the alarms went off. Everybody ran in. You had been OD'd. And here's what was happening with me. I saw blackness, and then a swirl of energy drew me way out here. And I thought, oh my God, I'll never find my way back. This is what my mind's thinking. I am way out here. When suddenly I hear my doctor calling my name, like he's far, far away. And I think, boy, if he stops calling, I'll never find him. So I turn around and I start following that sound of him going, John, John, hear me, John. John, wake up, John, John. He keeps doing that. So I'm following that voice when suddenly I get to a tunnel, and the tunnel has a vacuum, and it sucks me through the tunnel, and I'm flying fast as can be, and suddenly I come out the other end of the tunnel into the room in the hospital. Bam, there I am, and I look up, and they're all standing around the bed. I got stuff all over my body. I'm looking at them and go, what happened? So I have experienced the body being out cold and me lost and alive somewhere in the other dimensions. And yet I got drawn back and woke up in the body. I threw up for 2 days. The stuff affected. And I had the sweetest night nurse that night. This was an angel of the Lord, because I threw up every 15, 20 minutes on those sheets. This lady would come in, don't worry, honey, don't worry. She would roll me one way, put the sheet out, put a clean sheet in, roll me the other way. I'd go on to the clean sheet. She'd, okay, relax, try to get through it, but you're going to do it again. And I did it, I swear to you, about every 20 minutes, my body was terrible shape because of the anesthesia. But I woke up, and I finally walked out of there. Doctor said, do you want me to try again? I said, no, I'm good with that finger. It doesn't say. Death is not an option. So I didn't go back. Okay, this is going to help us with spirit. How many of you have had an animal, a pet you loved and knew for years, and then you saw their body dead? Me too. What was missing? When I looked at this little cat of mine, I thought, where is this kitten, this little cat that the essence of her is gone, but I have her carcass? So that's what Edgar said was really this kitten. Your real quality, natural self is your spirit. And the spirit of that cat was gone, and I had nothing but the body left. Have any of you seen a human that you knew well alive, then you saw them dead? The same thing, you look at their body and, you know, I looked at my wife's body and I thought, where is Doris? I mean, I have this carcass, but that's not her. You know, that's what he was saying when he said your natural, normal condition is your spirit. If you start to shift from looking at people's bodies and try to sense their vibes, their spirit, their essence, you will start to get into what Edgar was talking about, and death will be nothing more than vacating the physical vehicle. And Edgar says you don't have to wait till you die to have this experience. Every night when you fall asleep, sleep is a shadow of death. And if you can be more conscious during your sleep in awareness of dreams and activities while in spirit, you will be very comfortable when death comes. It will be familiar to you. If you haven't done that, then when death comes, it's a shock, and you wander around your dead body for days, he said, because you don't know anything else but this reality. I bet you thought I was never going to get to angels. I am. Angels, glorious angels. And many of us raised our hands, and thank God I've had contact with angels. One night they saved my life completely. If I hadn't had that angel, I would not be here now. Angels are of two communities, seraphim and cherubim. That's the original, two communities. Now, they spin out into multiple dimensions, especially if you study Jewish Kabbalah. You will get into the amazing complexities. You should look around the earth and then imagine the earth as also a heaven with all the angels. Then you'll see how complicated it is. You see all the different humans on the planet Earth? In heaven, there are all these different angels of different focus, quality, motivation, and purpose. Seraphim are literally, the word is Hebrew, and it means beings of fire. And you see fire associated with them often. Cherubim are guardians, and they have four wings. Seraphim have six. I think that's a human add-on to it. But anyway, they are the guardians. And this is the Ark of the Covenant, where God said you could meet me and have direct experience, and he told Moses how to build it. Well, one of the things he told Moses to do was put cherubim on there. Why? Because seraphim are beings, angelic beings of absolute truth. You can't come into their presence and say, well, you know, free will is a difficult thing. I tried my... You either are or you aren't. Get out of here. Cherubim are very different. And that's why they're on the Ark of the Covenant with the mercy seat. Yes, we understand. Free will is so tricky. And I know it's hard. And we will help you and all that. You don't go into the seraphim that way. You either are ready for them or you are not. But the cherubim are your guides, your guards. They help you. And then God tells Moses to put the cherubim in position with submissive wings like this. And then the mercy seats between them. This is the only way you can approach the Ark of the Covenant without fear. And you can't have fear in you. But because it is scary, you're going to meet the omnipotent infinite. Do you understand what's going to happen? They would tie a rope around your ankle. They wouldn't come into the Holy of Holies to help you if something went wrong. But they'd stand on the holy place and pull you out if they heard things going bad with the rope on your ankle. You didn't know all this subtle stuff. Oh, the Jews have all the history recorded. Solid. Well, you know, Aaron lost two of his sons in the Holy of Holies. They had the wrong vibes when they went in, and they died in there. Probably the guys holding the rope didn't quite know what was going on and didn't get them out in time or something, but they died. And Moses had to really convince Aaron to stay with the assignment because he was going to quit. He thought God was too mean. But I think what was happening is when you get beyond the loving guidance, you are in absolute truth. So even in deep meditation, when you get close to the omnipotent, you must have a humble, meek heart and be ready to acknowledge you have misused free will. And it's not because it was difficult, it was because you were learning. Do you understand? Then that's truth. But you go in there with an excuse and you're in trouble because no excuses. So anyway, I want you to be aware of that. I guess you realize now you want to meet cherubim. And they aren't those little angels of the Baroque period that are on the walls. They're not little fat babies with wings. I have met them. They are not. Okay, here are the choirs of the angels. This is the classical arrangement. Of course, you've got the great angels, archangels we call them, Michael, Gabriel, and Raphael. Just to show you how complicated it is, Michael has secret, all the angels have secret names, but Michael's secret name is Sabathiel. It means the Sabbath. It means the intermission. And Edgar Cayce talks about that. He says, if you would realize and just budget a little time to pull away from the busyness into the Sabbath break, you would actually become aware of the higher truth. But you're so busy, you're so active, your mind is running all the time, you're up and running all day long, you sleep like a stone because you've exhausted yourself and you have no sense. If you would pull away like the Sabbath idea, Sabbathiel, Sabbath, it's the intermission from this, your soul would be able to breathe and convey stuff to you. So his secret name has a powerful meaning. Once you get into angel lore, it is fascinating, and it's intimately connected with us. Unlike fairies, who don't really need us, want us, or elves. Angels are intimately connected with us. They are very much involved with us. Each one of us, according to Cayce and ancient lore, have a special angel assigned to us called our guardian angel. He affirms that over and over. Okay, here they are. Seraphim, cherubim, the thrones, the dominions, the virtues, the powers, the principalities, archangels, and angels, the nine choirs of angels. Here's Kabbalah showing them with the tree of life, the arrangement, the first trinity. They're broken into three trinities. That equals nine, if you're having trouble with me. Beings of fire, angels of knowledge and guidance. So they are the guides because they have knowledge. And one of their knowledge is they know how hard it is being human with free will. Thrones are the bringers of justice. That's karma. You will meet yourself. Edgar assures you of that. The bringers of justice. As you sow, you will reap. But let me show you mercy. Edgar Cayce gave a reading for two brothers who came. One was born blind, and the other one had normal sight. And they asked why. And Edgar from trance said, in a previous life, you were two of the greatest of the Cossack warriors. The Cossacks had a routine of burning the eyes of the enemy out with hot irons. The one brother did it as his duty, his job only. The other brother did it to inflict pain, suffering, and with a certain amount of joy. Then Edgar paused and said, do you see mercy here? You are only born blind. See? So, anyway, give you an idea of that. Second trinity of the choirs are the dominations or dominions. They are the angels of leadership. Virtues are the spirits of motion. Your virtue moves you toward goodness or the various other seven virtues. There are seven virtues, and I can't get into that right now. Powers are the warrior angels, and you definitely have warrior angels. My father being in the military and myself being in the military and my youngest son being in the military, we learned all the military lore. And the militaries of most nations have all, you won't believe it, all the militaries have legends and lores of being helped by legions of angels. I don't know. Third trinity of choirs are the principalities. They have hostility toward God. Why are they hostile toward God? Because they don't think God should have given humans a second chance. Genesis 6 should have wiped them out and never allowed them to live again. But God allowed them. So they're a little pissed off with God about letting us do it over. I found this very fascinating. Very fascinating. Anyway, archangels are God's messengers, and of course, pick one, like Angel Gabriel comes to Mary and announces her pregnancy, right? Angel Gabriel comes to Muhammad and gives him the first insights into spirituality, and the first part of the Quran is actually Muhammad conveying the messages from Gabriel. The second half is Muhammad getting more into the politics of the religion. Angels, guardian angels, every one of us has a guardian angel. And Edgar actually talked about us, we can act as a guardian angel. I'll give you an example. The first time reincarnation came up in the Edgar Cayce readings was 20 years into it. He had been giving nothing but physical health readings. You know what he was called a psychic diagnostician. Anyway, he was in Ohio, and Arthur Lammers asked him about his physical health. And in the reading, he said that he described his illness and how difficult it was and it was going to be hard. And then Lammers gets upset and says, well, why do I have this illness? Calm as can be. Here's how Edgar went into trance. Put his hands over his forehead till he saw a white light. Then he's lying down. And then he moved his hands over his solar plexus, And his wife told he started to go into deep breathing and REM, rapid eye movement. He was falling asleep on them, you see? And she would say, "You will have before you the inquiring mind of Arthur Lambers, his physical body, his mind, and all of this stuff, and you will give us information to help." And he said the white light would move, and he would move with it. And sometimes he said he saw a book of life that was Arthur Lambers. And the keeper of the book would show him what he could tell him and what he could not tell him. He couldn't tell him everything. Also, he said, "When I turned the pages this way, I was looking into Lambert's future. When I turned the pages this way, I was looking into his past." Do you see? That's how he did it. So he comes back and he says, "Why do I have this illness?" And Edgar comes back and says, "Because in a previous life in France, you abused the body, and this is the karma of that situation." Everyone was freaked out. Past lives? So the next week, the whole Cayce family got past life readings from Edgar. All of them were told they had incarnated during the time of Jesus in Palestine, except his wife, Gertrude. Well, she was miffed. She stopped talking to him. She was pouting. He said, "Well, what was it?" She said, "I love Jesus as much as the rest of you. This something's wrong with his reading." So he said, okay, honey. He's got to sleep with her, you know. He said, "Let's get a check reading and find out why." So they go in and they say, "You gave everyone in the family an incarnation in Palestine during the time of Jesus except Gertrude. What was going on there?" And the voice came back and was upset with them and said, "The suggestion was who was incarnate. The soul of Gertrude was not incarnate. She was the guardian angel of the disciple Andrew. And if she hadn't watched over him, he would have fallen off the path many times." Well, she was okay with that. Guardian angel, disciple Andrew. That's me. Do you see? Her soul could overlook and help an incarnate person. And according to Cayce, we all have this going on. We all have this dynamic going on with us. So this is the structure of the angels. It's arranged with the trinities of the tree of life in Kabbalah. Here's the tree of life, the great I am and the little I am and all the dynamics. These are considered the emanations of the source of life, our God, the creative force. And this is the secret place of the deep, where you go in and none of this expression is there. It's total peace. It's the womb of Mother God, your source of the first essence of life in you. Then you are expressed in these dynamics, the great I am. Well, here are the angels associated with each of the orbs of the tree of life, the emanations. Metatron is the highest. And everybody goes, "An angel called Metatron? That's not even Hebrew, is it? What is this all about?" You can see the angels we know well, but Metatron? And Metatron is both the great I am and the little I am. Do you see? Very interesting. Well, here is Metatron as we've been able to express it, understand it, and it has something to do with the Metatronic cube. Metatron means beyond the matrix, grace and karma, the ability to meet all the conditions but in a place of creative life-giving rather than pain and suffering and down-putting or judgment or criticism, self-judgment. All those are gone. You're working in this. In Hebrew Aramaic, if you take the word apart, Metaron, it means he who stands next to the throne of God. So next to the throne. So you are seeing the higher and the lower, and I just want to show you it's with us, within us, because we are a reflection made in the image of the Creator. So the little I am is in the image of the great I am. And if the little I am gets control of itself and starts using its free will to act more like the Creator, it becomes like the Creator. So that's why you have this idea of beyond the matrix and this great strange angel. No one is really aware of how that all got in there. But the Kabbalists, they didn't hedge. They didn't try to, they just put it up there. That's it. Here's the great Gustave Doré and his wonderful paintings of angels. And here it is. Now you see, the further you get away from oneness, you are more individualized, alone in your own body. As you get into your spirit, you are your angel self, and you still have personality and form. You're a unique angel, but as you get closer and closer, you become merging more with all of them, and you become more like one, and you are not discernible. You are in harmony with one. You couldn't tell God from you or you from God because you are in that harmony. That was the original place, and the Big Bang spun it out so everyone could have an individualized experience with freedom to choose and make choices and grow. And Edgar says, know yourself to be yourself, yet one with the whole. That's the goal. So here you see it here. Now here's the book of Daniel, of the Ancient of Days, and all of us are recorded there, and all the angels know this. I was very upset when I read this reading. I was in college, I was about 21 or 2, and Edgar said, every thought, every action is recorded in your book of life. And I went, oh my God, somebody should have told me this. Every thought, I was sick. For 2 years, I was a wreck. But then I read the reading that said, new thoughts overshadow old thoughts. And I said, I'm saved. So every time a thought would come up, I go, no, not that thought. And I started to watch my thoughts. And I was going to change what's written in the book. This is William Blake. He is a fantastic angel artist. Here's Jacob wrestling with the angel. Now, an interpretation like a dream is that this is your outer self seeking to know your higher self and to receive a blessing and a message. And sure enough, Jacob does get that. And his name is changed from Jacob to Israel, he who wrestles with God. Do you see? And that's what all of us are doing. We're wrestling to try to get in touch with our higher self. Here are the angels watching over the body of Jesus in the tomb. And then they open the stone and he awakes again. Here's Adam and Eve and their angelic spirits. This is, let's see, let me tell you the story real quick. Abraham and Sarah are promised they will give birth to the child who would lead on the Israelites. Well, Sarah becomes 90. She goes through her midlife change. She doesn't have any eggs anymore. So she says to Abraham, I don't know what God meant with that promise and everything. Why don't you go into my handmaiden, Hagar, and have the promised child with her? And like a typical male, he doesn't even think. Oh, okay. And he gives birth to Ishmael, the father of all the Arabs, who are now the Muslims. What do you think happens to Sarah a couple of months after Hagar births the baby? Yeah, she becomes pregnant. Yikes, 90 years old, she's pregnant. Then she can't have Abraham's mind moving between the two women, so she asks that Hagar leave with her child so Abraham will focus on Sarah and Isaac. And Isaac in Hebrew means to laugh. God made me to laugh by giving me a baby at 90. So I used to tease my mom. You know, she was 97. I used to tease her in her 90s. I said, now, you and Dad, be careful now. I don't want you to have a baby like that. And she would laugh. Okay, back to reality. Hagar is left with water and food for about 2 days in the desert, and Abraham leaves her. She is praying, and they pronounce her name Hagar. I have been in Muslim countries 40-some times. I've gotten to know them pretty well. And this story they tell, they tell it different ways, but the main one is this way. She starts praying to God for help. And suddenly, in her prayers, she looks up and baby Ishmael is tapping his heels on the desert floor and water is coming up. And she knows God has answered her prayer. And she feels, she hears God say, I will raise a great nation from your son. A child of Abraham, remember. And that great nation are the Ishmaelites. With the Israelites, Ishmaelites, Israelites. Later, the Ishmaelites break into 264 tribes of Arabia, and Muhammad unites them with the messages from Gabriel into one nation of Islam. And then Islam goes through a lot of changes and struggles, and right now, today, it's wrestling with itself to figure out what the next step is. But you should be aware that, and now remember I said Arab Muslims. These are not the Indonesian Muslims. Arab Muslims are the children of Abraham. You got me? Okay. The angel comes in. They really get involved a lot. Opens the door to the prison and lets the disciples out, and these guards fall asleep. The angels cast a sleep over them. I was in the military, and when I was in boot camp, I fell asleep one night on duty. It was Christmas night, and I miss my mommy. I was only 19. I mean, God. Anyway, the angels come and release all the disciples, the apostles from prison. Go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. It's in the Acts of the Apostles. How angels, now I want you to be aware, this is a physical activity. You have to unlock the jail. You have to knock these guys out. You see what I'm not talking about the bars melting or somehow magically walking through bars. Angels come and open all of those things. That's the way it happened for me. It was very physical. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat upon it. His appearance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. Matthew 38. And Mary and them came, and remember, when Mary first saw the resurrected Jesus' body, she mistook him for the gardener until he spoke. Then she realized who it was. Remember on the road to Emmaus, the two disciples that were chatting with the resurrected Jesus did not recognize him till he spoke, and then they knew it was him. So there's something about the magic of your ascended body that's slightly different than the physical. Where this is counterbalanced is Jesus says to Mary, don't touch me, I haven't ascended to the Father yet. And Edgar comes in with his readings and says he hadn't balanced all the forces yet. It would have harmed her to touch him at a higher vibe. Later, when he's in the upper chamber, he's got the balance and he tells Philip, come put your finger in the hole in my hand. You'll see, this is really me. Then later on the beach, he's actually eating fish and honey, masticating fish. This is a physical body now, do you see? So apparently, there is an assimilation of your spirit body, your resurrected body, and your physical body. So anyway, that's what we'll do there. We'll move on. Okay. Now, Jesus talks about little children having angels, and you must be very careful what you do to a little child because their angels are always before the face of God, the Father in heaven. Remember this passage? And I love this artist. She's a Mormon artist, but I don't hold that against her. It's a joke. Beautiful work there, showing how natural, but a very important, see that you do not despise one of these little ones,
For I tell you that in heaven, their angels always behold the face of my Father who is in heaven. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. This is Paul writing. So I'll quickly tell you my angel story, because I was unaware that I was in the presence of an angel until he left. And then I realized what I had missed out on. When I was in my 20s, I was the manager of a bluegrass band. We used to play all around. And Rocky Top was our opening song and our closing song. We had a great time. Well, we were up in Minot, North Dakota. You almost are out of this country. That's how far away we are. Way up there in Nowheresville. And we didn't get done till like midnight. And I'm driving back to Virginia Beach in my car. And I come down out of North Dakota into South Dakota, and I'm going to go across the top of South Dakota and then down into Nebraska. And it's about 2 a.m. now. So I'm coming across the northern part of South Dakota, when I see a hitchhiker on the road, 2 a.m. Normally I would never, but I couldn't stop it. I mean, I was impelled to pull over and pick this stranger up. He gets into my car, closes the door. I pull out again, and we're going, and he says to me, where are you going? And I said, I'm going to route so-and-so and turn south. He said, you don't want to do that. That will drive you through the Wounded Knee Indian Reservation, and last week they shot 2 FBI agents. They are not going to treat a young white boy nicely if you drive through their reservation. I had no idea. Wounded Knee, I hadn't been reading newspapers. I didn't know. I said, oh, no, I don't want to do that. He says, go up to route so-and-so past that turn, then turn south, and you'll be okay. So I say, okay. So I drive past the Wounded Knee reservation at 2 or 3 a.m. I turn to the other one. He says, I'll get out here. So I stop the car, pull over. Now, I'm in the Great Plains. The Great Plains. You can see to the horizon. There's nothing in your view. You have to understand that. He gets out of my car, closes the door. I look back. There's no traffic. I mean, there's nothing on the road. I look around. I look for him to make sure I don't hit him or something. And he's not there. So I get out of the car. Now I can see forever. And he's gone. And all the hair on my body stands up. And I realize, oh my God, I picked up a guardian angel who kept me from getting beat up, at least, if not killed, by offending the Indians. And so I got back in the car. And I'm just like, somebody knows I'm out here. That's what really scared the poop out of me. Somebody knows I'm out here. And I drove to Nebraska. You know, it was so weird. But that was one of my best angel encounters right there, unawares. Explain enlisting the aid of angels and its spiritual and material significance to these particular entities. Every experience is an assurance. And he has given, behold, the face of the angels ever stands before the throne of God. The awareness in self that thou may be one with, equal with, the Father God, as his child, as the brother, sister of the Christ, thy Savior, thy brother. And as the awareness comes, it is as the angel of hope, the angel of announcing, the angel of declaiming, the angel that would warn, the angel that would protect. So see all these qualities of service that certain angels can do. For these are ever as awarenesses, as consciousnesses of the abiding presence that, quote, he hath given his angels charge concerning thee. By that very desire that, Lord, thy will be done within me today. So you see how intimately connected angels are with us. Fairies are not given this charge, elves are not, but angels are intimately connected with human beings and are involved in our lives, even when we're not aware of it. And again, he states it's an awareness, it's a consciousness. It's not so much the physical. Is it through the guardian angel that God speaks to the individual? Answer, ever through that influence or force as he has given. Quote, ye abide in me, and I in thee. As the Father abides in me, so may we make our abode with thee. That's John 14:15. And then as the guardian influence or angel is ever before the face of the Father, through same may the influence ever speak. But only by the command of or attunement to that which is thy ideal. What then is thy ideal? In whom have ye believed, as well as in what have ye believed? Is that in which thou hast believed able to keep ever before thee that thou commits unto him? Yes. And then I put this in red. Through thy angel, through thyself that is the angel. Kabbalah teaches each of us is an angel. Gertrude was the angel guardian over Andrew. Each of us has an angelic quality. Does the self speak with the ideal? Then he tells Gladys, his stenographer, to capitalize the word ideal. Ideal is that paradigm of truth that you seek or believe in. That's your ideal. What is your ideal? You really, he wanted us to sit down and actually write down our ideal, spiritually, mentally, physically. And he said to do it in pencil, because as you grow, you will change and you will want to rewrite that. I have done that for some 40 years. It's a challenging thing to do. Recently, I've noticed my ideal has gotten much more mystical, expansive. But when I look back, I was looking at my journal from 1986, and I have a life on one side and dreams on the other. And my ideal was so physical. I mean, I need this amount of money. I want this type of relationship with my wife. I want this job. I want that. Now it's so different. But the important thing for you to be aware is that despite your personality's sense of aloneness, you have within you an angelic being who is ever before the throne of the Father, ever before the face of the Father, and you came from the womb of the mother, and you will return to that. I mean, you really are a part of this whole thing, even though life is crazy, and tomorrow you will have to put your pants on, you will have to pay the mortgage. Yes, mundane life goes on despite this high ethereal thing. The spiritual nature of angels is expressed in the account which Zechariah gives of the revelations that came to him as the ministry of an angel, and that the angel spoke in him. Unfortunately, new revised biblical translations have changed that the angel spoke with him. But the little adverb was in him, talked within me, is exactly the original, if you look at it in the original Hebrew. For all must coordinate, just as the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, so within self, body, mind, and soul. He said illness was when you're out of sync with this. The Kabbalah agrees. Illness is disharmony in the function of the dynamics of ourselves. When we're sick, it's because we're out of balance, out of harmony. And he's saying pretty much the same. Mind is the builder. Mind is the way, as the Christ consciousness. Christ consciousness means conscious of God, God consciousness. As it is directed then through the influences of the bodily functions, it becomes aware of its oneness. And oneness is health. And thus is the guardian force made to be at one with the whole of the purposes and desires and the will of the individual. Edgar explains that the two nervous systems, the central, the brain and the spinal column and all the nerves that I use, and the autonomic, the deeper nervous system, they can get out of harmony. And when they do, you have a dis-ease between the two nervous systems, and if that stays, it becomes disease. Do you see how he's playing that story? You must have the inner nervous system in harmony with the outer. And he said that is determined by purpose and desire. Are the purposes and desires of the outer self in harmony with the purpose and desires of your inner self? These things then, as we find, as indicated, and we will bring to the physical forces better cooperation and coordination. Now health's going to come, you see. And thus, through the mental application of at one ment to the creative, life-giving forces, better reactions in every manner. Now, I just put these here to show you the Trinity is not just a Christian, Christian idea. I have talked with rabbis and Jews about Trinity. They are uncomfortable with that pretty much until you show that they're just aspects of one God. They will not move off of the one God, and they're worried that Trinity is three gods. It's not actually that. It's three aspects. Hinduism also has the great Trinity of the one infinite, Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. And they are like, this is like the creator, the father. This is like the active guiding us, one with us, with the ideals and the power and the help we need. And Shiva is the destroyer. But when you study it deeply, he's the destroyer of illusions. Now those break our heart because we don't want to give up our illusions. But we grow by suffering the reality that what you thought was ideal is not. And then we come up with a better ideal and we grow. So Shiva is part of this. That would be the Holy Spirit, which Jesus says brings all things to your remembrance, even the ones you don't want to remember. You know, your life panorama. So that's the Trinity there. Through thy angel, through thyself that is the angel. Keep that in mind that, yes, there are lots of angels, dynamics and all, but you are among that, and you are growing to become one with the community of angels and the source of your life. So I've taken us the journey, and I've left some time for questions. And if you have any questions, you can ask me, or if you want to share something, you can share.